This program is brought to you by the Center for a Sustainable Today. Our world is an amazing, complex living organism, and we coexist in a symbiotic relationship. With this great power comes a great responsibility, a responsibility to ensure the future by taking steps to be sustainable today. Here is the host of Sustainable Today, Jean Valman.
Hello, and thanks for joining me on Sustainable Today, the show that helps you take actions right now to become more sustainable both at work and at home. Today's program is on climate change. Nations across the world are already preparing for the UN's climate change conference in Copenhagen in December of this year. The Kyoto Protocol that outlines greenhouse gas reduction targets expires in 2012, so global renegotiations are already underway. Now, there's an ever-increasing urgency to take action now, and Bill Bradbury, Oregon's former Secretary of State, recognizes this urgency. Bill is with me today to talk about that. Good seeing you again today, Bill.
Great to be here.
Now, you've made over 160 presentations of Al Gore's slideshow. So tell me, what have you learned from that in the last 2 years?
What I've really learned is that there's been a real change in the attitude of the public. There's been more and more concern and what can we do. There's also been more and more people, as President Barack Obama got elected, some of the deniers got really energized because all of a sudden they had someone in the White House who was actually going to push for real change
right.
in terms of climate. One of the things that happened to me that was most striking was I was making a presentation to a group of sixth and seventh graders in Beaverton.
Mm-hmm.
And I made the presentation to them, and they had a class on climate change, and they were just gung-ho, ready to do all these things to deal with climate change. And they said to me, they said, now, if we do all these things, is the world going to go back to the way it was, and we're going to be able to enjoy ourselves outside?
What did you say?
And I sort of looked at him and I said, oh, I so wish I could tell you that that's what it's going to be. It's all going to go back to normal. But I can't tell you that.
Right.
All I can tell you is that if we keep doing what we're doing now, it's going to get worse. That we're sure of. Scientists are sure of that. But they're not really sure how this unwinds if we control our greenhouse gases. They're not sure that everything goes back to the way it was.
Right. Makes sense. Well, we're going to talk a little bit more about that here in a few minutes. But before we continue our conversation, Bill, I'm going to report just a little bit of news. So let me just tell our audience, as reported in Reuters, a coalition of investors with $7 trillion portfolio are urging companies to disclose their water use and to reduce their water-related financial risks. For instance, a Coca-Cola plant just a couple of years ago was forced to shut down in India because they were damaging and depleting the local water supply. Now, the Water Footprint Network studies and then advises industry on water matters. They estimated, for example, that producing 2.2 pounds of beef takes an average of 4,230 gallons of water for feed crop and beef processing. And a cup of coffee, well, this is unbelievable, it takes about 37 gallons of water to produce, not to mention the cup of water in the coffee pot. It's just crazy. So anyway, fresh water, as you know, Bill, it's a limited resource, and aquifers are being drained faster than they can be recharged or refilled. And with the rising global temperatures due to climate change, glaciers are melting worldwide. So Jason Morrison, the lead author of Water Scarcity and Climate Change, asks a simple question. Where will water come from in the future? A great question. I don't know the answer, but we're going to talk about that on another show. Now, there's no surprise in this next little tidbit of news from the AFP that reports at the 79th International Geneva Motor Show that's being held in March, most of the 120 new or modified cars offered fuel savings or lower emissions, whether it's subcompacts or more hybrids or more plug-in electrics. And this stop-start mechanism that saves fuel automatically by stopping the engine during standstills. One of the reasons I bought a hybrid this last year. Anyway, I'm hoping that the U.S. industry is paying attention to this. Now, so Bill, I want to start actually with the skeptics, because we know that they're all out there. It looks like about 30% of the population still thinks climate change isn't happening. So I want to find out from you, what do you say to these folks? So my first question, where did my first question go? My first question is, I understand that a vast amount of science climatologists are saying it's here, it's human caused, no question about it. So when you come across a skeptic, what do you say?
Well, I basically go through an entire show talking about some of the very real, very local impacts that we're seeing from climate change. Mm-hmm. And they're left with a rather difficult situation, which is they don't have a slideshow showing how I'm wrong. Mm-hmm. And I talk about the huge consensus that exists in the scientific community. Mm-hmm. And it's not at all unusual for a denier to raise a concern and say, well, wait a minute, this scientist says blah, mm-hmm. says something else. And I basically try to explain that the real beauty and the real strength of science is that nothing is ever absolute. That science is always the role of questioning. And basically you see scientists coming forward asking questions, good questions, demanding answers. And there are always going to be those kinds of questions in science. But when you get so many scientists coming together saying, yes, climate change, A, is happening, and B, is primarily, not only, but primarily human-caused, it's pretty stunning mm-hmm. when you have thousands of climate scientists agreeing that that's what's happening. That, I think, is a very strong and a pretty overwhelming opinion.
Well, let me shift gears then. So can you describe in a nutshell for our audience, what really is climate change and how is it affecting our lives right now as well as in the future?
Well, climate change is basically caused by an increasing release of greenhouse gases, and there are six greenhouse gases, the most prevalent greenhouse gas is carbon dioxide, which comes out of a tailpipe, comes out when you burn coal, comes out when you know, any number of things go create carbon dioxide that goes in the atmosphere. More and more carbon and carbon equivalent, we call it, basically greenhouse gases, are building up in the atmosphere. And as that builds up in the atmosphere, it traps more and more heat inside that atmosphere because the sun's energy comes in but can't get out. So that's what's happening more and more, as you're seeing more and more warmth being kept in by the greenhouse gases.
The greenhouse effect is what you described, but then what is the effect to our lives, to our businesses, our communities?
Well, you start to see a whole series of things, whether it be increased hurricane activity, greater strength of storms. Hurricane Katrina, Hurricane Ike are great examples. You see more, because there's increased drying, you see more forest fires, you see an increase in tornadoes, you see an increase in really dramatic flood events where you see really big floods around the world. Those are all things that are the effect of changing the weather system on the globe. I mean, that's really what's going on. You have all these different changes taking place as the weather system really starts to change because it's fundamentally getting warmer, and that changes the entire weather system that we're all used to.
Right, right. Hey, I just understood from an article I read earlier this week that the polar ice cap, which we all thought was going to be hanging around for decades and decades, is actually perhaps going to be disappearing by, what is it, the summer of 2013?
2013, 2014. Scientists now say polar ice cap, the Arctic ice cap, is really, in the summer, it would not be at all surprising to see it be gone in the summer by, you know, another 5-6 years.
Yeah, so it's surprising.
Really quite striking. Mm-hmm. And if you look at what's happening with Greenland, which is sort of the other part of the Arctic ice cap. You look at what's happening there. The glaciers on Greenland are rapidly declining, and they're way. What's going on is things are happening way more quickly than scientists actually projected that they would.
Well,
nobody projected greenhouse would the Greenland ice cap would melt so quickly.
I mean, isn't that an argument for some of the folks who are saying, "Hey, look at those climatologists. They don't know what they're talking about. Look how they're constantly re-changing their models." Isn't that an argument that they don't know what they're talking about?
Well, it's an argument that the Earth's weather system is a real complicated system that's all interconnected. It's also an argument that actually takes you the other way and basically leads you to believe that the scientists that have been meeting in the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, thousands of climate scientists from around the world on the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, sponsored by the United Nations, come together and they try to find consensus, and then they work with their governments to try to find consensus. And basically, I think the argument would be that the IPCC has been too conservative.
Right.
Things are happening way more quickly than people were saying they might.
I'm thinking that's going to fit into this Copenhagen meeting then in December, right?
Right. I think clearly climate scientists and world leaders are going to get together in December of this year, 2009, in Copenhagen to try to negotiate a new climate treaty, because they've recognized that the existing climate treaty, Kyoto, is not good enough.
It's not going to cut it. Right. Now let's go from the world for just a minute, and right here in Oregon, tell me, how is our situation any different, better, or worse from a climate change perspective?
Well, I mean, Oregon, from a climate change perspective, Oregon is better than other places that are going to have much more trouble with water than we have. You go to Phoenix, Arizona, oh my goodness. But there's big changes happening. If you look at the glaciation on Mount Hood, some of the biggest glaciers on Mount Hood have already shrunk 61% in the last 100 years. There's shrinkage on the glaciers. You're looking at they're doing analysis river basin by river basin. They finished the analysis on the Rogue Basin. It shows summer temperatures will go up by about 12 degrees Fahrenheit by about 2060. So 12 degrees right now, it's 90 degrees on the Rogue River. It'll be 112 degrees.
I bet salmon are in trouble.
That leads to serious problems with salmon. It changes the native vegetation. You see all these kinds of things happening. They're proposing now that we need to create what are called cooling centers for people to come and stay reasonable in terms of the temperatures. As the climate gets warmer, they're looking at, like on the upper Willamette, the need for cooling centers. Eugene, Springfield, areas like that, Oak Ridge, have cooling centers for particularly those more vulnerable people so they can come and be sure that they're cool.
See, I was thinking that Oregon, you know, being that we're here in this little trough of the climate pattern, the current climate pattern, that we'd be, you know, pretty much immune. But what you're saying is not at all.
No, we're not immune, although I will say I would much rather be living in Oregon as the climate changes than living in Phoenix, Arizona. Mm-hmm. Because Phoenix is, in fact, in the middle of a desert, dependent on water dammed on the Colorado River. And if you've seen the reservoir on the Colorado River recently, you know that the water supply that Phoenix depends on is shrinking.
Right, right.
So I'd much rather be in Oregon, where we're not going to feel as many horrible things as some of the places that are more exposed, like Phoenix, are going to feel.
Now, I remember was it a year ago or 2 years ago when the wine industry came together to sign some pledges around making a difference?
Right.
Because the wine industry is going to be really affected here.
Very strongly. Actually, one of the signature grapes in Oregon, Pinot Noir, a red wine grape, really sort of the ultimate Oregon vine. And basically, scientists would expect that you know, in another 40 years, 50 years, Pinot Noir is not going to grow in Marion County, in Yamhill County, in Washington County, and down the valley. It's going to grow on the coast, maybe.
Yeah.
But, and that's all based on the fact that Pinot Noir requires cold cooler nights and warmer days to grow effectively, and that's going to change such that it doesn't grow so well.
Wow. Well, that really is not only an economic impact, but it's going to change communities. So really important to be paying attention to climate change then in our own communities.
I think so.
I just have one quick question. That is, this is a little bit about the science. What about the other gases? You mentioned all six of them, but for instance, methane, you know, 20 times more potent than carbon.
There's a real challenge with methane that relates to, methane is produced when you have things rotting. The huge challenge created with methane is in the permafrost regions in Alaska and Siberia, where as those regions start to melt, you have this huge release of methane. I can show you someone doing a pickaxe into the snow on top, and they can light a fire.
Just from the methane that's
being released, and then they hit it again a little bit harder, and it explodes.
Oh, my gosh.
So, I mean, it's just incredible.
Okay, Bill, that's a little bit of a gloom and doom scenario. So let's pause your story for a moment, okay? Great. But it does say to me that it's even more important to take action now to cut greenhouse gas emissions. So we're going to learn what one local business did to do just that. Reporter Kirsten Richards takes us to the Blue Heron Paper Company, who partnered with the Energy Trust of Oregon and the Climate Trust to make dramatic changes in their business operations.
We're here at the Blue Heron Paper Company with General Manager Eric Jensen. And Eric, you're going to tell us a little bit about what you guys do here. And first of all, why don't you tell us what Blue Heron is and what kind of products you produce here?
Blue Heron is an employee-owned company that really began to be Blue Heron back in May of 2000. Previous to that, we were part of the Smurfit organization. But we had an opportunity to become employee-owned, and that's what we've been now for the last 7 years. We, at this mill, have 250 employees, and we make a variety of grades, primarily newsprint, but we also make fast food bag for McDonald's, actually make about half the paper for their bags for the whole country. We make another paper which goes into advertising inserts and that sort of thing.
And recently you guys collaborated with the Energy Trust and Climate Trust to kind of create a more sustainable way to produce this paper. What has the collaboration done for you guys? How has it helped you guys conserve?
Back in about 4 years ago, the Energy Trust came to us really looking for an opportunity to invest maybe up to $100,000 to find ways to reduce energy in our mill. What we presented them with was an opportunity to spend quite a bit more than that, but at the same time to save a lot more electric power at a more efficient way than what they had been doing up to that point in time. With the help from the Energy Trust and the Climate Trust, we were able to expand our denking process from a plant that consumed about 500 tons of waste paper a day to one that consumes about 625 tons a day. As a result of that, we were able to shut down a process that required a great deal of energy.
All right, great. Let's go take a look at those machines.
Okay, great. Here we've got a truck from the local area delivering some of the paper left over from the printing operation from a commercial printer. And we use this in place of a magazine to supply the denking operation. We receive quite a few truckloads like this every day that come from the local area, although much of what we get is bailed from a longer distance. When we're running at full capacity, this plant will process about 625 tons of waste paper each day, a mixture of magazines and old newspapers. That will produce about 500 metric tons of dank pulp. Everything we make at the plant here has recycled pulp in it, About 75% of the total furnish that we use to make our paper is recycled. Some of our paper has as little as 50% and some as much as 90%. It just depends on the grade and the machine we're making it on. This device here is called a flotation cell. This was really the key piece of equipment that we installed with the funds from the Energy Trust and the Climate Trust. And this device here, we're floating the ink out of the fiber, using a lot of air bubbles and some surfactant to cause it to come to the surface. Then we skim that ink off and remove it from the process. The way it works, it keeps the fiber that we want to make paper with in the process. It just removes the ink.
And that money from the Climate Trust and the Energy Trust helps to shut those other ones down that were less efficient.
It shut others down that were less efficient, but also they consumed more energy to pump. We still have to pump this material, but it doesn't require nearly as much horsepower. So besides having the opportunity to use less refiner pulp, which is very energy intensive, the new plant that we put in required less horsepower to operate it. In this room, we have the heart of the refiner mill. This is the location where we grind wood chips up into the pulp. This is really the most energy intensive part of our process because it involves two refiners, each of which has a 12,000 horsepower motor attached to it. When we look at trying to reduce energy in this mill, most of our attention has been focused on this area, trying to reduce the amount of TMP pulp or refiner pulp that we use. And the way we do that is to expand our capability to make recycled pulp or de-ink pulp.
How much do each of these use in terms of energy?
Well, each motor is 12,000 horsepower. Each one can consume about 8 megawatts of power. So in this room, there's about 16 megawatts consumed, and the total mill consumes about 50 megawatts.
Okay. And have you been able to reduce that in any way in here?
The way we reduced it was really to reduce the amount of time that this has to run.
Okay.
Before we expanded our de-inking project, our plant, we actually ran this plant about 100% of the time.
Okay.
We had two refiner lines that we ran most of the time. We've been able to shut down one refiner line completely, and then the current line runs about 75% of the time. So we've really reduced our total consumption from the neighborhood of 35,000 megawatt hours a month down to something less than 30,000 megawatt hours. We are using about 6,000 or 7,000 megawatt hours per month, less than we were before, which is enough to power a few thousand houses. Here what we're doing is thickening the pulp that we made, that we ground up using the refiners over in the other building. So we just grind it up into these fibers here, so it's ready to make paper at this point. It needs to be brightened a little bit, but other than that, we just take this and blend it with the recycled pulp.
What percentage of the paper comes from?
We average about 25% of our pulp comes from this.
Okay.
The other comes from the recycle.
As we look over here, we can see everything working. And when you think of a mill, you think of the smell, you think of, you know, the pollution, but not always the...
We pride ourselves in really being more environmentally friendly than a lot of mills. Our process does not produce odors that escape our plant site. When you see steam coming off of a plant like this, it really is just that. It's steam or water vapor. There isn't any chemistry involved in it. And that's a fallacy in the minds of a lot of people as they drive by and see emissions off a plant like this. It is really a much more environmentally friendly process than what they think.
We'd like to thank the Blue Heron Paper Company and General Manager Eric Jensen for allowing us to come out to the plant today. Thank you.
I appreciate you giving us a chance to tell the Blue Heron story.
You betcha. Thank you. My name's Kirsten Richards, giving you the tools today to be more sustainable.
Well, joining me now is Mike Burnett. He's the Executive Director of the Climate Trust. Welcome, Mike.
Thank you, Jean. I'm very pleased to be here to discuss the most important challenge that humanity faces.
I love that enthusiasm. Great, thanks. Hey, now, my understanding is basically is that unless we stop putting carbon dioxide and greenhouse gases in the air, or we can suck it out of the air, then we're going to be escalating climate change. So clearly we need to step up. So, Mike, there's been a lot of talk about emissions cap and trade, carbon taxes, carbon credits. I mean, the lingo goes on and on. So let's start with carbon tax. What is that? How does that work?
Well, sure, Jean. I think it's very important for people to put the challenge in context. And President Obama has just released his cap and trade proposal, and it calls for essentially a 90% reduction of greenhouse gases. And so essentially we're talking about essentially a totally carbon-free economy. So it's a big change and a big challenge. So there are a number of ways to get there, one of which is a carbon tax. So how a carbon tax works is we add a tax to the use of fossil fuels, more for coal than for natural gas, because coal releases more carbon dioxide per unit of energy.
And who bears that tax?
Well, pays that? Ultimately, it's borne by whoever uses the fuel, is whoever pays. So it comes, you know, companies and individuals in the end. It's kind of borne all the way up the chain of purchasing that leads to the use of that fuel. Carbon tax is has certain price, so the government sets a tax. We know what that cost is. Everyone can respond. That's the good part of it. The bad part is the response is very uncertain. Turns out that consumers are not terribly sensitive to price changes for fossil fuels. So, for example, when we had the very painful gasoline price increase from $1.50 to $3.50 per gallon,
right? That was
over the term of the Bush administration, we mm-hmm. could say, and that is equivalent to a $200 per ton of carbon dioxide carbon tax, which is way higher than any carbon tax anyone's talking about. We had this effective carbon tax, and meanwhile, the use of gasoline increased by 10% during that time frame.
So what you're saying is that there's not much of a response to in the consumer marketplace when you add a tax.
Yeah, there's some response, but you know, I'm very doubtful that we could do this alone with a carbon tax.
Okay. Well, so that takes us to this next one, which is the emissions cap and trade system. How does that work?
Well, yeah, first let's talk about cap, and then I'll add trade.
Okay.
So cap, what this does is provide certainty about the amount of emissions. It's, you know, very important that we get the physical quantity of emissions down to the levels that we scientists have told us we need to. And so, you know, kind of rather than relying on a price mechanism, we rely upon a quantity mechanism. And so this has certain quantity but uncertain price. So kind of pro is certain quantity, con is uncertain price. Okay, so how a cap works is we set an overall cap for the U.S. economy or for the state of Oregon, and then that gets divided up among businesses, let's say, and then each business then has a certain cap. The cap then declines over time. This means that a business then has to take actions to reduce its emissions, get more efficient, invest in renewable energy, you know, do things differently.
So I can emit year one, but I have to emit less and less as time goes on.
Probably about 2% per year less, and we're on the trajectory is to increase, not decrease right now. And so that's the cap, okay? So every company has got to reduce, okay? Then the trade comes in is maybe some companies have better opportunities than others to reduce, okay? So they can not only meet their cap, they can go beyond meeting their cap and generate some excess. Other companies might have difficulty meeting the cap, or it might be more expensive. So then you allow a trade to occur where the company that is able to bring about more reductions is able to sell them to the other company who needs them and at a lower cost than the company that's having trouble.
So that might be because my company can gain those efficiencies quicker, faster, more economically viable in doing that?
Exactly, Jean. Okay. So that's the point. And the point is that it's lower in cost to the company, the buying company, but it's also lower in cost to society as a whole to be able to add the trade to the cap.
Okay.
Okay. And since we have such, and we're talking like a total turnover of our energy system, it's very important that we figure out how to address climate change at the lowest overall cost, because that leaves more money for everything else we really want to do. I mean, we don't want, you know, you know, we want stuff for healthcare and food and, you know, shelter and security and all those things we really need. And so it's very important that we do this economically efficiently.
Well, that's making sense. So let's add the last one, that, because I've actually bought these, so I want to make sure I'm understanding what I'm buying, and that is a carbon offset. How does that fit into the scheme of things?
Okay. Well, carbon offset is really a part of a cap and trade system. And it really provides a third compliance mechanism. So if you're a company and you're required to comply with a cap, you can either do it in your own facility, so you can invest in efficiency and kind of get more, you know, do things differently.
That's kind of reduce what Blue, that's what Blue Heron did.
Well, yeah. Well,
in terms of investing in its own efficiency.
Well, yeah, and so you can reduce at your own in your own smokestack. Mm-hmm. You can trade with another company, or let's add in offsets. Okay, offsets is you go to somebody who's outside of the cap, who has a certain emissions amount of emissions that isn't going to change, and then you pay them to reduce, okay? And then this comes in and is used as a mechanism for the company that buys those emissions reductions to comply with the system. And so offsets then add another flexibility mechanism, they're called, and it's another cost savings. And the analyses of the federal cap and trade bills show that kind of with and without offsets makes a huge difference in kind of the cost to society for putting this into place. And there's a number of types of things that we're not talking about capping in forestry and agriculture where we can actually sequester carbon, pull it out of the atmosphere, and most likely at a lower cost than a lot of the other things that we might do.
Mm-hmm. And well, so what's the optimal combination of all of these mechanisms?
Well, I mean, I think the optimal combination would be a cap and trade mechanism with the carbon offsets. And then, of course, that is going to raise the price, I mean, of the fossil fuel. So you do get some price response, and you do get the public a lot more aware of this. But I think the certainty provided by a cap and trade and the cost efficiency by allowing the trading and the offsets are really the right package to put together. It makes the most sense.
Okay, great. Thank you. It sounds complicated, but then as you talk about it, it actually seems like it has some pretty simple moving parts. But it's a complex system.
It is a complex system, but it's kind of dealing with the complexity can be done. And it's very important that we do so, because if we kind of shy away from dealing with that complexity, then we end up with something where we don't get the economic efficiencies, and it's going to take much more money to be able to mitigate the emissions, and that's going to crimp our style in other areas.
Well, let's talk about that a little bit. So how does all this fit into public policy? Because really it's public policy that needs to put all of these things into motion, and public policy is where you balance everybody's interests. So, Bill, could you talk a little bit about that?
Well, it fits into public policy at the federal level, and our president has proposed a cap and trade system federally. It fits into public policy at the state level. Our governor, Ted Kulongoski, has proposed a cap and trade system for us in Oregon, joining with other West Coast states. The reason to do something on a state level with other states is because everybody believes that it's going to take the federal government longer than we shouldn't wait for the federal government to enact cap and trade. We should move forward on it as a West Coast coalition of states and Canadian provinces to deal with the problem. So that's what's going on legislatively in the Oregon legislature right now and in the Congress, although that's going to be kind of delayed a little. There's consideration of this whole cap and trade issue to try to reduce greenhouse gases.
Mm-hmm. Now, isn't there another alliance somewhere in the United States that tried this or is trying this?
Well, there are three alliances. There's the East Coast. There's nine states on the East Coast. There's six or seven states on the Midwest, and then there's seven states in the West, plus four provinces in Canada. that have all joined together in the Western Climate Initiative, WCI.
Let me just switch this a little bit to the green economy, because I think it's all related. And I read a UN report that mentioned $2.7 trillion by 2020 in the U.S. relative to the green economy, which pretty much relates to climate change. Do you have any insights or thoughts about that?
It's very clear to me that this is one of the best economic development opportunities we have, and we need them now. Mm-hmm. And it's real clear that when you add up all the renewable energy investments, add up all the biofuel investments, add up all the green building investments, add up, in addition to that, what is called the smart grid investments of really reconfiguring our electrical distribution system, you get to, it's estimated, you get to 66,000 new jobs in Oregon and Washington by 2028. So it's pretty clear to me, and those are good paying jobs. We're not talking, you know, minimum wage jobs. We're talking engineer level jobs. It's an incredible opportunity for us. And I just have to say one other thing, and that is Oregon is really sort of surprisingly really well positioned right now.
Well, that's what I was just thinking. I mean, we already have really good incentives. We already have programs in the state. So say a little bit more about that.
Well, I think obviously with wind, you see wind in the Columbia Gorge on both Washington and Oregon side of the Columbia River. But what's so dramatic to me is solar. And Solar World, a company from Germany, a big solar manufacturer, located a plant in Hillsboro, Oregon. Okay? So that just like, oh. And all of a sudden, there are all these other spin-off companies around Solar World that are, you know, in Albany and Eugene and Portland. And it's just phenomenal. Oregon today is the leading solar manufacturer in America.
I did not know that. That's amazing.
It's unbelievable. I mean, how many jokes do you remember about how rainy and cloudy and, you know, it is in Oregon? And we are the solar manufacturing center of America.
Now, we might be the manufacturing center, but is it on our rooftops?
Well, there's getting to be more
exactly.
And clearly, there's, even though it's cloudy here, there are significant solar opportunities in Oregon, but also significant opportunities for solar facility or solar panels and solar photovoltaic systems to be developed and built in Oregon.
Now, are you seeing the same thing via the Climate Trust, just these kinds of business opportunities?
Oh, yeah, I think this is, as Bill said, it's the greatest investment opportunity I think we've ever seen. We need a huge changeover in the energy system that underlies our whole economy. And Oregon is particularly well suited as a hub for this. We have an edge on sustainability that goes back all the way to, you know, the land use laws in the state. Now, so we're like the world experts on smart growth. We have leading edge organizations on energy efficiency and renewable energy and carbon offsets. I mean, the kind of all of the kind of the key underpinnings are here. And we have national, international leaders in all of these fields located here in Portland, Oregon.
Now, how much of our expertise that you just described really are we exporting to other states, other areas? I mean, are people asking you to go and present and kind of share best practices?
Yeah, Gene, in a number of ways. Going back to the early 1980s, the Northwest and Portland has been a hub for energy efficiency.
Right.
And we have a whole large cadre of people who are national, international experts. And we have companies that are running programs all around for utilities all around the country that are basically, you know, coming out of, you know, Oregon-based initiatives. And a lot of this came about because we had farsighted laws that we implemented first. And so we implemented these laws first, we developed the expertise locally, and now it's a major part of the kind of intellectual capital that we have that is in high demand elsewhere. We at the Climate Trust are running a program for the state of Colorado. We run programs for five huge utilities, total sales of $100 billion way back in the East Coast. They're coming to us for the expertise that we at the Climate Trust developed because we were the ones, you know, because Oregon was the state that said we're going to do carbon offsets first.
Great.
It's much like in the state of Oregon, we export high quality windows all around the West now. That is a result of some of the most advanced building codes that we put into place in the 1980s that basically made our window manufacturers make these highly efficient windows for our market. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, California wanted them. All around the West, they wanted them. These are now giant companies. Right. They
that's
weren't
excellent.
Giant before.
Right. Well, that's exactly what I wanted to know, because I suspected not only, you know, were we just getting good here, but, you know, we're really helping the rest of the nation, you know, do the same in their own backyards. So that's great. Thank you. I'm gonna pause here and just stay with us though, because we'll come back for one final question, because probably none of us are really directly connected with exactly what Bill and Mike are speaking of, and we certainly aren't directly connected with the negotiations that are going to be happening in Copenhagen. But we are all likely contributing to the problem of climate change, because our lives and the products that we buy and our homes and the food that we eat, our businesses and communities, we all depend upon fossil fuels in some fashion. So you might be wondering out there, what can each one of us do in our own lives? Well, here in Oregon, most of us can take advantage of a free service. Well, it's not actually free because we pay for it through our energy bills, but it's a home energy review administered by the Energy Trust of Oregon. So let me show you how easy it is and how valuable it is to take advantage of this program. I pulled out my energy bills from last year, and I made a list of questions that I have for Sean. He's the energy advisor from the Energy Trust of Oregon. He's going to be here any minute to do a home energy review for me for free. If you're an Oregon customer of PGE, Pacific Power, Cascade Gas, or Northwest Natural, you too can get a free home energy review. It's easy. Just call Energy Trust or go online and schedule an appointment. And relax. You don't have to clean your house or anything. They've seen dirty dishes before. Trust me. There he is. Hi.
I'm Sean from Energy Trust.
Hi, Sean. I've been expecting
Hi.
You. Come on in.
Good to meet you.
You too.
All right. So, anything particular we're looking to do? Reason for calling?
Absolutely. Yeah, I got this, made this list after I talked to the service rep who I talked to, and the first thing on it is that fireplace over there. It kind of breathes. And I just wonder if I have adequate insulation everywhere.
Sure, absolutely. Great. Do we want to take a look at the furnace? Furnace and water heater?
It's downstairs in the garage.
Perfect, okay. Those would be great places to start.
Okay.
Okay. So we'll just take a quick look at the furnace and the water heater and just the general condition of the ductwork. That is connected right here. This is outside the house, so we want to just take a quick look at it. First things first, great furnace. Furnaces can be a little bit expensive to install, so this is a non-issue in a good way.
I'm pleased with it, yeah.
Good piece off our checklist. So some of the things that we're looking for are areas of potential leakage. The furnace is actually pushing air into the ductwork into the house, so if there's leakage out here, it's considered leakage in the ductwork also. So there is, I definitely can feel nice warm air coming out here. There's quite a bit of heat right here.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I had no idea.
So it's unsealed and uninsulated. I can see where there are some areas where there is duct tape on it, and duct tape is not necessarily what we want to use on ducts.
Say that one more time, duct tape?
Duct tape,
you don't want to use on ducts?
It's just a period of time before it'll just fall apart.
Oh, wow.
Furnace filters up here, you change them on a regular basis?
I do. I buy a year's worth at a time, and okay. I mark the date, and I change them at the first of each quarter. Oh, yeah.
That's a nice color. A gray.
A nice gray.
So the easy way to tell if it's really plugged up is just take your light and see what you can see. And the answer is, it is time. So I can switch it out for you real quick.
I think the carrier says in its instructions to change it every quarter. So are you saying that might be too often?
It may be too infrequent.
Oh, too infrequent?
Right. We would say check it every couple of months.
Okay.
And then change it as needed. But again, like I say, every house acts a little bit differently. You had replaced the water heater, I presume, recently?
I did have to replace the water heater.
Okay.
And, you know, I've heard about water blankets, water heater blankets, mm-hmm. but not to put them on the later models.
Yeah, we can tell, and that is true, we can tell what the temperature is on the outside of the water heater, and it is pretty warm. It's 70 degrees is what that says. Mm-hmm. So it may not have a lot in the way of insulation on it, but that is absolutely correct, is you generally want to check with the supplier or the manufacturer mm-hmm. and see if they prescribe putting a blanket on it. A lot of times the water pipes, the ones coming out here, are exposed and they have zero insulation on them. So we yeah. would say that they should be insulated.
And on both of them? Because I was thinking yeah. about that too. Yeah. So on both of those?
Exactly. So that's showing 80 degrees.
Oh my gosh.
And that one is showing 83 degrees.
Now so, I thought one was the cold water coming in
yes.
and one's the hot water going out.
That is correct. But the cold water pipe dips so far down inside of that tank that it is actually, it starts pulling temperature backwards after it sat for just a little bit. So,
well, where to from here then after?
Let's take this. A look at the crawl space, being how we're talking about the ductwork, and we'll see if there's any issues with the ductwork under the house.
Okay, perfect. This way. Oh, hey, Sean, these are two of the dampers that I keep closed because I don't like to heat this up down here at all.
Okay. Well, we should take a look at these anyway. So what we want to do is have this open slightly, and we want to check the connection of the vent to the house itself. And this is an excellent example of where it is not real well connected. When I put my hand down here, I can actually feel cool air coming out from under the house.
Oh, yeah.
And it's not exactly where we want to have air coming into the house either. So we want to have that really well sealed. Typically, that is considered part of the air sealing of the house. Now we can go continue and take a look at the ductwork from the underside of the house. So some of the things that we're looking for in here, where there is, it's called ghosting, where there's a gray area on insulation, it can either show us leakage on ductwork.
Oh, there and
exactly.
There.
This area right in here, you
That's
see,
filthy.
Yeah, you see how dark it is. So a lot of times where the plumbing has been punched through, which is this area, there is definitely potential for air leakage in there. Some of the areas that we can see on the ductwork as a good example are, it's gray right here, right where it comes off of the plenum for mm-hmm. the furnace. I think the plenum is, it is a case of they'll never see it. It's underneath here, under the plenum itself. So I don't believe it was ever originally wrapped up.
From when they first built the house, you mean?
Yeah, quite possibly.
Wow. So I'm losing heat right away from when the hot air comes out of the furnace.
Exactly right.
Just
right
immediately.
Right off the bottom of the furnace.
Oh, uh-huh. man.
Yeah. Gene, where you said you were concerned that this area is extra cool, well, here's a good potential reason why uh-huh. this insulation needs to be strapped up nice and tight against the bottom of the house.
Sean, this is the area where those steps are at, and the air just comes gushing through here upstairs.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, a lot of times on multi-level houses or tri-level, that the backs of the stairs are really leaky, potentially.
Is there anything else down here?
No, I think we're good. We should probably take a look at the attic. Would be a great next maneuver.
Excellent.
Okay. All right. So we'll just take a quick look in the attic. We're looking for, say, weather stripping on this hatch. This is an outside door, in essence. And just put like a vinyl type weather stripping on it. And I have some downstairs. I can show it to you, too. All right. The insulation level is not bad. It's not perfect. It could handle a little bit more. Code has changed since the period of time that this house was built. The wall in here looks good. The insulation looks like it's well tucked up against the wall. It's not falling away or anything. Okay. And then the bath fans look like they're connected well too. They're venting all the way to the outside of the house.
Oh, great, not just into the attic.
Exactly. Okay. We don't want the moisture moving into the attic. We want to move it all the way out. Mm-hmm. And then one other thing, I would have a contractor take a look and see that there is adequate roof venting in here. We may be a little bit shy.
Okay, perfect.
Okay. All right. So hatch is back in place. Just want to make sure that it's sealed up well. Oh, I was going to say, as long as we're right here in the master bath, mm-hmm. is we can take a look at some opportunities possibly to save some water. We have shower heads that we install also as part of the visit.
So free home review and free stuff.
Absolutely.
My showers only are 5 minutes or less as it is. So is that really going to save me a lot?
A typical brand new shower head, even if it came as new fixtures, are about 2.5 gallons a minute. Oh. This is typically around 0.5 gallon less per minute. This one is 1.75 gallons per minute.
Well, there's both sides of it. There's the water reduction as well as the heating of the hot water. Well, I sure hope that feels good.
We'll check it out.
Oh my, that looks great.
Yeah, and it's adjustable spray on it. I mean, these definitely have a good rating and a good flow on them.
So I think the last thing to do is to talk about the fireplace, isn't that right?
Sure, we'll take a look at it. Oh, that's right, real quick, since we had talked about it earlier, the cold air return,
right.
The placement of it, mm-hmm. It just seems like it's in a good position.
Oh, hey, while we're right here, between this light and that light, they're the only two that I haven't switched out to compact fluorescents. Uh-huh. I've just kind of been waiting until they burn out.
Perfect, because we have them and we can just install them today as part of the visit.
Oh, just right now?
Sure.
Yeah, oh, we can do it great. Right away. Okay, perfect. All right, well, we can come back up to that. So I was going to ask you about this fireplace because it's so drafty. Here's that thing that I was mentioning.
It is that bypass that we saw, that in-feed for the fireplace.
Right. Okay.
So it's just freezing cold air coming in here all the time. But I think if they do the pressure test on the house, they're really going to say, let's just close that guy up.
And then they'll leave this looking this way, but they'll take care of it from below.
Right. You can seal it up from underneath.
Yeah. That makes sense.
Perfect. So let's take a quick look at the fireplace,
just
a damper.
Just feel that right back.
But there's no gaskets on these guys, so even when it is so-called all closed up, that there's still potential for air to move out of here.
Now, I'm pretty sure I had the damper closed completely.
Closed up.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yes, it looks like it is closed up. Which is kind of surprising, the amount of air that's moving in and out of it. There's a pillow that you can inflate and actually park inside of those guys. It will typically make it more airtight.
Gosh, I'm really excited to look at this review, Sean.
Okay, perfect.
So what did you discover?
All right, so we found a few areas that you were concerned about. Mm-hmm. One was...
After the 45-minute visual inspection, Sean looked at my energy bills. He figured that my average monthly bill was a bit higher than it probably should be for my home's square footage. He gave me materials on what I could do myself. For instance, on exterior walls, I can install switch and outlet cover gaskets. I've already installed a programmable thermostat. He suggested two tests that I should run. A blower door test that checks the air pressure of the house and identifies air leaks. And a duct pressure test to see where the air ducts need to be resealed. There are plenty of places where that's a problem, starting in my garage. Sean showed me a list of trade allies familiar with the Energy Trust programs who can do those tests as well as the repairs. Several of them can also do a comprehensive analysis of my home's energy use and air quality.
Potential is Home Performance with Energy Star, which is this program, which is more extensive testing. They do a whole house approach. They check for moisture levels, carbon monoxide levels, make sure everything is safe and burning correctly, everything is in really good condition.
Sean completed the worksheet of his findings, and then he got to the money part.
This is the sheet that we'll actually leave behind.
Okay.
So this one will have the actual recommendations or the things that we found specific to your house.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then this one, you can just refer to as, if it's checked off on this one, then this is what the incentive amount is available per each of the items that specifically apply to your house.
Now, how do I get these incentives?
This is actually through Energy Trust, mm-hmm. And you just do an application with us, and we just send out checks, actually. It's actually cash back. Yep.
I like that. I'll want to also apply for the state's tax credits for any of the work that I have done. After replacing my incandescent light bulbs with compact fluorescent ones, he was off to his next appointment.
All right, Jean. Very good to meet you.
You too. You
Thanks
too.
For having me in. And two, if you need any additional help, just give us a call. Also, just take a look at our website at energytrust.org. It's really helpful also.
Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
All right. Take
Great.
Care.
Thanks, Sean.
Okay.
I'm Jean Bauman, bringing you the tools to be sustainable today. I'm an everyday gal, making my everyday choices count. And you can too. I better go get that list and see what I can work on this afternoon. Bye-bye. Well, Bill and Mike, thank you so much for being on the show today. You really brought a lot of valuable information to our audience.
So.
Well, I have one final question for both of you. What do you think are the most important things that we need to do to address climate change? Bill, I'll start with you.
Well, I think it's sort of a combination. When I do climate shows to people, I make it clear that there are a whole bunch of things each individual can do, whether they be using compact fluorescent lamps, or whether they be weatherizing their home, or whether they be driving a higher mileage car, or keeping your tires inflated, okay? There's a whole bunch of things each individual can do, but none of that is going to make any difference unless the government enacts the kinds of policies we need to dramatically reduce carbon equivalents in the atmosphere. So it's a combination of individual things we can do and having the government really act, like with cap and trade and carbon tax, to really clamp down on it and get our ability to reduce greenhouse gases.
Thank you. Makes a lot of sense. Mike, do you have a different perspective or some additional ideas?
Well, yeah, I wouldn't say I have a different perspective,
right.
But a complementary perspective. Mm-hmm. I think business as usual is not climate as usual.
Right.
And business as usual is climate far from usual. And this is a very urgent problem. And so, yes, everyone should try to minimize their reductions or minimize their emissions and learn more about this. But I think we need to communicate the sense of urgency to the politicians. And it's in everyone's interest to do so, not just for the legacy for our kids, but we're talking about creating huge number of jobs, good-paying jobs here, in Oregon and in our country. And we have a dire need for these for jobs, ever more so than we had just a year ago. And so, go tell your political leadership to get on board and support this, because it's in all of our own interest, not just in the long term, but in the short term, and especially for Oregon, which is a leader in this whole field. It's a real opportunity for us to jump out ahead, and it's very important for our state to be a leader.
I couldn't agree with you more. That is really good advice. We can all do things in our own lives. We can do things in our own businesses. But what we really also need to do is be in touch with those policymakers and legislators to do the right thing and to do it quickly.
Right.
I think the sense of urgency is what I'm really getting out of today's show. So thanks again.
You bet.
Well, that's it for our show today. I hope you've enjoyed being more sustainable with me. Hey, now, if you can, we want you to go to our website and give us some feedback on the show, whether this is the first show that you've watched or whether you're a regular viewer. It's really important to us to have your feedback. So what do you like about the show? What ideas do you have for shows in the future? Because we want to know what information you want to see and hear so that we provide you programming that's most valuable to you. In the meantime, I hope that you are more sustainable with every choice that you make every day. Thank you for watching.
There's a big, beautiful planet in the sky. It's my home. It's where I live. You and many others live here too. The Earth is our home. It's where we live. We can feel the power of the noonday sun. A blazing ball of fire up above, shining light and warmth enough for everyone, a gift to every nation from a star. It's a big, beautiful planet in the sky. It's my home, it's where I live. You and many others.